Today on an all-new Till We Make It, a very sensitive topic. We're talking about fantastic finishing moves. Yours, mine, and everybody else's. I'm Mike Quackenbush. This is Till We Make It. And today on the program, something for you, my buddy Sin Bodhi. You know what we're talking about. Finishing moves. When I first started traveling the American independent circuit back in the 1990s, from time to time, I would end up on cards that were being headlined by Jimmy Superfly Snuka. And there was a guy who used to travel around with Jimmy Superfly Snuka, who shall remain nameless but had a glorious mullet. And his main job was to walk around the locker room and make sure that nobody else was doing a splash off the top rope on the event except for the Superfly. But after I'd heard his spiel three or four times, I began to think to myself, is there anybody out there so ignorant as to think that they should do the one thing Jimmy Superfly Snuka is famous for on the same card as Jimmy Superfly Snuka? And apparently the answer to that question was yes. So allow me to now make one more impassioned plea to you, my fellow professional wrestlers. If you're out there, you need to be a student of the game. If you happen to be booked on a card where Ric Flair is performing, I feel like you should not do the figure four leg lock. I feel like that thing, which is synonymous with a far bigger star than you or I most likely are at this stage of our career, should have that reserved specifically for them. And flipping that around, as someone who has trained a lot of professional wrestlers, if some of my own protégés were working on a card where the Dudley Boys happened to be wrestling, and a match or two before theirs, some of my own kids were out there doing the 3D, I would be mortified for that news to come back to me, because I feel like that is a sign of disrespect. All of us, no matter where we're at in our journeys as professional wrestlers, need to be cognizant of the other performers booked on cards where we happen to be. Because no matter how big of a star in any one region or any part of the planet you might be, somewhere out there is someone that is an even bigger star than you. And they are deserving of some respect and a little bit of admiration, even if it's someone whose work you do not personally enjoy. Because those that have come before and have blazed a trail make it that much easier for all of us who follow in their footsteps in one way or another. And even if it is an older wrestler who you have never heard of, never watched, and were never a fan of, if not for the work that they have put in, this thing right now that we are all enjoying would not be anywhere near as awesome if our forebears hadn't done a whole lot of that hard work for us. So if you happen to be booked on a card where Jake the Snake Roberts is also appearing, I don't care that you do 9 fascinating variations on the DDT. On that particular night, the DDT is exclusively reserved for the man who made it famous. And let's take this general concept and expand it into something even larger. Let's not restrict this just to finishing moves. What about something that is very character specific, like seeing Elias smash somebody with a guitar? I can think of a few ways that this thing might run askew. So let's say somewhere in the future you happen to be booked on a card with Elias, and your shtick happens to be that you also play the guitar and then hit somebody with it. Well, unless the booker has specifically contrived something super fun, which I can't wait to see, and make sure to link below in the comments to it, then I bet you won't be the one doing the guitar shtick that particular night. Well, what if you hit people with some other instrument? You use a flugelhorn instead of a guitar to hit your opponent. Again, please link below. But I think you might reserve using a musical instrument as a foreign object just for our buddy Elias. I think he gets to have that. What if you happen to do some other kind of in-ring shtick that always devolves into attacking your opponent? I think at the very least, you might want to saddle up next to Elias, mention to him what you normally do, and then ask him what he is planning to do. And if it turns out that he happens to be a bigger star than you are, it wouldn't be the worst thing ever if you deferred to him. Let's take this same concept now and extrapolate it even further past moves. What if it's just a character ritual? What if your shtick happens to be cupping your ear toward the audience, listening for a reaction? I can think of at least one professional wrestler who is a bigger star than you and I who also does that. And if for some weird reason you happen to be on a card with that dude, you should probably leave the whole ear cupping business to him. So I hope that even though I don't have a really sweet mullet, you do get the intent of what I'm trying to share with you about finishing moves and even expanding on that into other character beats and certain rituals that famous professional wrestlers might use and employ. And one day, when that is you, you will no doubt feel a great swell of appreciation when you appear on cards where everyone else is as respectful of your trademark material as we are being toward these legendary or otherwise larger than life characters right now. And because of the story that my friend Sin Bodhi related to me when reaching out about this exact video, because it struck me in just such a way, I want to relate to you now a personal story from my career, which I am fairly certain I have never spoken about in public before. And it's about one of the first moves that I imagined that I invented. It's the original Quackendriver. I first started doing the move that I refer to as Quackendriver Classic way back in 1996, and I got the idea from watching Razor Ramon. I liked how he picked people up for his razor's edge, and I thought, what would happen if I turned that move around, and instead of dropping them back first, I got them to fall face first? And all I did was kind of keep pulling on that thread until I discovered the thing that ended up becoming the Quackendriver. And then, a few years later, I got an email from a friend of mine who had said he was on tour and watched on the tour bus how the entire roster of people that he was traveling with happened to be watching a VHS tape of one of my matches. And initially, I was extremely flattered by this. I thought, wow, that's so cool that they happened to be watching a match of mine. And among these matches, you can bet, I was doing the move that I was very proud of back then, the Quackendriver. Well, don't you happen to know, just a couple months later, I happened to see footage of someone else doing what I thought was my move. And then before you knew it, there was somebody doing it off the middle rope. And before you knew it, someone had changed the name to Iconoclasm. And then I had people coming up to me at live events saying, hey, that's a really cool variation of the Iconoclasm. Where did you learn it? And boy, would that get my undies in a bunch to feel like people didn't know that me, this little tiny indie wrestler that nobody had ever heard of, had invented something he thought was cool, and yet you thought it was somebody else's. And I don't mind sharing with you, there was a period of time where that sort of thing used to get me really hot under the collar. I felt like I had created something original, and I had put it out there, and somebody else had taken it from me and was using it for their own gain. And then I eventually had to come to terms with this idea about all creative output that I want to share with you right now, and I mean it very sincerely. No matter what it is that you create or make, chances are it came from somewhere else. It was inspired by something you saw, just like my Quackendriver was inspired by Razor Ramon. And if Razor Ramon showed up and was like, hey Mike, I think you owe me a royalty on that, I don't know how we'd calculate that monetary value, to be honest. There are some schools of thought that tend to say this: there are no creative ideas left in the world. Everything that's out there has been done before. And to an extent, I kind of agree with that idea. However, there is an endless array of variations on ideas and concepts we've all seen and heard before, just waiting to be discovered through the application of your creativity. So it's entirely possible that you might see something that I did, and then you take it, put your own twist on it, and make it your own. And I want you to know, I think that's awesome. Thank you for that. And if I happen to see something of yours and I'm going to take it, I want you to know I'm going to find a way to put my own unique stamp on it before I walk it out on stage and call it anything other than whatever it is that you happen to be calling it. And last but not least on this topic, it doesn't matter if it's wrestling moves, it doesn't matter if it's an illustration you make, it's a song that you composed. Once you put that out into the world, once you release your creative output in front of any kind of audience, including an audience of one, it is no longer yours. And you and I might not necessarily like those terms, but I'm afraid it doesn't make them any less true. Once you release your creative output into the world, it no longer belongs to you or me. It belongs to the audience that is experiencing it. And what they do with it, what they take away from it, is completely outside of your control. So if this move that you invented, or this song that you composed, or this illustration that you have made is so dear to you that you just can't bear the chance somebody else might take it, modify it, ape it, or pay homage to it, then you need to keep it to yourself. because that's the only way it's going to remain entirely safe. For the last few years, I have become increasingly convicted of this point of view, that professional wrestling is performance art. And no, you're not going to drag me into your Twitter flame war about it, but I will substantiate this claim with a story. And the backbone of it is this: all art is subjective. For more than a decade, the song that had more plays on terrestrial radio than any other composition on Earth was the Police song, Every Breath You Take, which was written by their frontman, Sting. And if you hear Sting tell the story in interviews, he is fairly unabashed about stating it's a song about stalking a woman. In a very candid interview I happened to watch with Sting some years ago, he talked about his relative shock that people would correspond with him, thanking him for Every Breath You Take, because it had been the song played at their wedding during their first dance, that the thing emblematic of their entire relationship was what he wrote as an ode to stalking. But just like all the moves, or the spots, or the character rituals that we create, once Every Breath You Take was released out into the world, it was no longer Sting's. And what it meant to him was in no way, shape, or form indicative of what it would come to mean to the people that experienced it. And I happen to think the exact same thing is true of what we make in professional wrestling. It's performance art, and that art is subjective. It will always be interpreted by the people that consume whatever that pro wrestling content is that we put out. And after we release that output into the world through whatever means we might use, social media platforms, streaming services, or otherwise, it is no longer ours. Part of why I make this is because I am thinking ahead to what your legacy in professional wrestling might be. And yes, some of it's about the lifestyle, and some of it's about the journey, and some of it is about the legacy. And so allow me now to try and reconcile what might seem like two disparate points of view. Because in the beginning, what I was saying was there are certain moves or spots or character rituals that belong to certain professional wrestlers. They are the ones that made them famous, or they are the ones that pioneered them. And yet what I am also saying is that once you put that thing out into the world, it is no longer yours to claim. So that might strike you as being two opposite ends of two very different arguments. But I want to bring them together with this as the unifying element. What will be your legacy in professional wrestling? We could all do a lot worse than to be remembered for how respectful we were of others, those that came before us, those that pioneered things, made them famous, or innovated them. And you can absolutely respect that by just being a good student of the game, and otherwise, just being a decent-minded individual when you were performing on with people who are of legendary stature or are otherwise bigger stars than you and I happen to be. And if you are one of those people who happens to take great joy, like I do, in creating or innovating something new, you've got to come to terms with and be comfortable with the fact that there is no negotiating this particular agreement. If you do put it out into the world, there are people who will take it as inspiration. They will want to pay tribute to it. They may do it in homage to you and the way in which you influence them. And there are also people who will rob you blind and steal that from you. And they feel justified in doing it because of the thought that there are simply no original ideas out there, or because that particular individual can't be bothered to think of one for themselves. In the last calendar year, I have had two personal friends reach out to me, stating that they felt an original creation of theirs in the world of professional wrestling had been appropriated by someone else and then taken up to a bigger stage where they were receiving no credit for the thing that they created. And I want you to know, I believe both of these people. I think it's true. And there is some good in getting that off your chest and saying it out loud. That's kind of exactly what I'm doing here with a story that's more than 20 years old. And if you happen to have a story like that and you want to drop it below, I want to hear it. I believe you. These things happen all the time. But I hope that you can keep these two things in mind, which I also have to remind myself of every single time I feel any of that negative emotion or that venom bubbling up inside of myself. Once you put it out into the world, it's no longer yours. That's the agreement. No negotiating. That's the way it goes. And also, the people that really know what's what, they know who the innovators are. They know who those creative thinkers are. They know where the originality and the inspired thoughts come from. And the way in which you will best distinguish yourself, no matter how long your career in professional wrestling might be, is by going about the business of continuing to create. I hope this is helpful to you today. I appreciate it might not be helpful to you until you're a little bit further down the road in your journey as a professional wrestler. But no matter where it meets you, I do need your subscribe and your like and turn on notifications. So the next time I publish a Till We Make It, you get notified. Now you go on, keep being awesome, and I will go on. I'll keep making the videos, and together we will keep on faking it.